2017 at 7:07 PM. Could I have a call to order, please? And a roll call, please, rather, sorry.
I was like, I will call the meeting to order.
You want my gavel?
I order this meeting to be called, present Barbara Stein.
Present Katie Dugan.
Present Jean Estino.
Present Ellen Marr.
Present Amanda Zani.
Great, okay, and if you would like to join us in the Pledge of Allegiance, you're welcome to do so.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And just as a reminder, all regular school committee meetings are televised and recorded. So the first item on the agenda is invitation to speak. And does anyone have any questions or comments they would like to share? Okay. So then the next item on the agenda is approval of the warrant. And do I have a motion to approve warrant 17-21S?
So moved.
Do I have a second?
I'll second.
All in favor, roll call, please.
I, Barbara Stein.
I, Katie Dugan.
I, Jean Estino.
I abstain, Ellen Marr.
I, Amanda Zani.
Okay, next is middle high school news, but our student representative is not with us tonight. Unless Jack would like to tell us what's going on upstairs.
I'll take a pass on that.
Okay.
Recovering from
even for extra credit, Jack.
Everything is good, right?
Okay. All right, next is the monthly finance update.
So I think everybody has F1 and F2. As handouts, I guess we'll start with a handout that deals with grants and revolving funds. We're mostly through the year, and there's nothing really dramatic to report. Spring fees are coming in pretty heavily right now for the athletic department, so when we close out this month, that number will change. We're working on getting together the letter and sending out the information about bus transportation. That'll be going out reasonably soon. And in terms of grants, I know that there's been some concern about the state's financial condition and has that made a difference. And frankly, the state has been just fine in terms of making grant payments. We don't expect to see any reductions this year. And in fact, on April 4th, we got our third quarter circuit breaker payment, so that was almost $107,000. It's not reflected on the sheet since it ended on March 31st, along with about another $54,000 in payments for two other grants, the Metco grant and Title I.
John, that $107,000, was that the third or fourth payment?
Third. We still have one more left to go this year.
Yay, that was my question.
I was like, okay, we need to get back to a $200,000 balance.
Fully expect to be there.
Okay.
So far, the state has met its obligation. There hasn't been any reduction at all, and they are not talking about any changes in certainly the FY17 grants. And while there's been lots of discussion about next year's state budget, I haven't heard anything that would talk about making a change from the allocations they've talked about for FY18 as well. Now, of course, we don't have a number for Circuit Breaker yet for FY18.
Yep.
So that is a big grant for us. It's over $400,000 a year, so we'll have to wait and see what that turns out to be once the budget goes through. Although I think, as you know, and I've sent information out, Katie, that the governor's number has been upped by the House of Representatives, so that's nothing but good news.
It is good.
So the payments for Circuit Breaker are basically even, so we should expect another $107,000 or so in the fourth payment?
That would be the expectation,
okay.
And in fact, these last few years, if anything, it's been up slightly over the other three quarters.
Okay.
At the end of the year, they spend all of their money, and over these last few years, the state has been a little cautious about how they've allocated that pot.
Okay.
Any other questions on this?
No, it's pretty straightforward.
It is. And then in terms of expenditures, we're starting to look, and things are going about on track as we expect. There's some, there'll be some deficits. I've met with Katie and Ellen as part of the Budget Advisory Committee. Some things that will require moving money around, but there's nothing that is gonna cause us to be concerned about meeting payroll or coming out with a positive balance at the end of the year.
Good.
So we're starting to think past the current month and what it's gonna look like coming to the end. And in fact, Ellen and I just spent a few minutes trying to forecast what utilities will be for the rest of the year. That's a little art and a little science, but we're pretty comfortable with what it looks like.
Okay. Yeah, but my question on that was, I was gonna ask you if you had done any forecasting for the end of the year yet. I'm sure that you, it's an ongoing process.
It's an ongoing process. In schools, always the big number is salaries, and will we be able to cover salaries? And the answer is yes, even though we've had some surprises along the way. We'll be okay.
Good.
All right?
Okay, so I have one other question.
Okay.
So just on the grants, the IDEAS Fed grant,
mm-hmm.
is there still more that's coming in then, or?
Sped, which one?
IDEA.
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 Yeah.
About 240.
Oh, the 240 grant?
Yeah, you probably know that.
Yes, we still have some more money coming in the 240 grant. In fact, on last Friday, I applied for another release of $7,800 for the 240 grant.
Right, because that's you get it as you spend it.
We
right?
get it as you spend
that's
it.
Right, okay.
We get it as you spend it. In fact, on the 21st. I applied for another $79,293 in grant funds to be sent to the district.
Okay.
I expect that all of that will come in time to be on the month-end statement for April.
Good.
Katie? I just had one question on out-of-district tuitions.
Mm-hmm.
It looked like we must have been making some quarterly payments, because if I was looking at this correctly, it looks like Circuit Breaker balance went down by a little over $100,000 February to March, and then when we look at the operating budget, we also had another change in the total expended by roughly roughly over $100,000. So we spent $200,000 in out-of-district tuitions during the month of March. Does that sound right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. We
It's 109,688 out of the operating budget for March.
Yeah. We started the year by spending money out of the Circuit Breaker account and then switched over to the local appropriation. And I spent some time with Mary Buchanan, our SPED director, our people services director. And it looks as if, knock on wood, things are going as forecasted, so we don't expect any deficits in that account at any time. There's still a chance for things to come along and surprise us, but we're in pretty good shape at this point in time.
And the private out-of-district placements tend to bill 3 months at a time, so they'll send us a 3 month, as you probably noticed.
This warrant contains many
yeah.
bills,
right.
The one that we just approved
yeah.
tonight.
And then some of the bigger private schools were what we prepaid, so that would show the difference.
Mm-hmm.
In what sort of was coming in on a regular basis.
So you guys forecasted through the end of the year and we're looking like we're on target? Because
yes.
we do have a, you know, we're basically going to take, as I see it, we're going to take the next two Circuit Breaker payments and just put them in the bank per the plan.
Per the plan that
for
the committee laid out last year.
Yeah,
right.
In fact. And then we still have an unencumbered balance of $420,000 in out-of-district tuitions in our operating budget, which will hopefully, as you said, carry us through
yeah.
year end.
Correct.
Okay. That is great.
Yeah, last year for April, May, June, and July, we spent $150,000, $197,000, about $550,000.
Yeah. Does that include June where we would have done some prepayments?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And I know that this year we were paying first out of circuit breaker and then second out of operating budget. I'm not sure that's the way that we did it last year necessarily. Great, thank you.
I just had a similar question about the Title I grant. Is that, is that paid out in quarters as well? I know you had said that you've received some.
No, we actually, we file for Title I funds monthly.
Okay.
Title I is a salary grant for the most part.
Okay.
Pays for two salaries, reading specialists at Deer Hill. And it's a federal grant.
Okay.
And so as.
Title IIAs as well.
And so as we look at, we look at the Title I numbers, you can see that there was a $1,200 deficit.
Right.
At the end of March, and that was a timing issue because on April 4th, we got the transfer of $7,913 from the state for Title I. So. So it was positive on March 4th, and of the $79,000 I applied for on the 21st, $7,882 is for Title I.
Okay.
It's also worth noting that about this time of year, the federal government looks at its allocations, and some schools, particularly charter schools, have refused some of the funding. So they reallocate it, or they allocate it because there's been a demand. There's been a decrease in Title I funding from the state, for the state income, by $69, and an increase in Title II by $110. So there's always that little variance. Sometimes it's a lot, sometimes this year it should be a little, that little flux.
Okay, all right, great. So we're done with this.
And then the other thing is your handout agenda item F2, which is the monthly maintenance report. School buses. I'm so happy to say this is not at all exciting.
You like that exciting.
Yeah, I like it when it's not exciting. Buses are on the road. We've had some minor repairs to deal with, some sort of nagging issues that have dealt with a few alarms on the buses, but nothing major. We did take April vacation as an opportunity to have some preventive maintenance done on some buses, because this becomes a very busy time of the year for us. As some of you so well know, there are lots of sporting events and lots of transportation that goes on. A little small mini bus that doesn't get a lot of use gets used pretty heavily this time of the year.
I have a request.
Sure.
In looking at this report, it dawned on me that we have obviously all the school buses leased and owned, and then items such as the minibus, but the food services van is not captured anywhere. And I'm wondering if we can, we're starting fresh with that van, it's new. I'm wondering if we can have some kind of an accounting of anything that gets done to that bus. Keep track of the mileage. I'm sure that the mileage will be negligible because it's mostly around town driving. For the condition of the old lunch bus, it was amazing to me how little mileage it had on it.
And how many years it lasted.
But I just.
In fact, it was slowly rusting away.
Absolutely. It looked horrific, but it,
yeah.
It still ran. So I think that it would be helpful for us if we include that in the transportation budget. In the maintenance budget, so we can see what we're spending.
Sure, although I'm going to ask that we keep it as a separate,
and that's
fine. All by itself, because all of the costs at this point in time, all the costs associated with the food van, come out of
the revolving
out
account.
Of the lunch revolving account.
Right.
So
you know, it would be kind of helpful to know if we got a lemon, if we got a great,
great
vehicle.
Sure.
You know, just to kind of keep an eye on all of that.
Okay.
Go for going forward, particularly.
We can do that.
Okay. Great. Any other comments on the transportation report?
I just had a question, not on the report, but just an update on the status of the lease extension. I know that Susan Franklin and you were trying to work on.
I have to rattle Susan Franklin's cage. I haven't heard from her in a while.
Okay.
And we need to move that along.
Okay.
Yeah. I believe that capital budget had some specific suggestions they wanted to make on the lease.
Yeah.
I haven't gotten anything from them.
Yeah. I know you handed her.
I gave her a copy,
yeah.
And in fact she asked for an electronic copy, which
okay.
I sent her the next day.
Okay. Okay. If you need some help rattling, just let us know.
Okay. Anything else? No? Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Shall I dig it from here?
Good, one more.
Yeah, disposal of supplies.
As you know, we're moving right along with transforming the middle high school library into a learning commons, and part of that is cleaning things out. What you have in your F3 document is a list of 221 items that were weeded out of the library. They range from publications of 1983 to 2002 that are obviously either obsolete, in poor condition, or not relevant to our studies at this point. And we're asking you, your permission to dispose of them. They include VHS tapes, audio cassettes. We're not sure if we can find a cassette player. or a VHS tape. And some hard copies of the 80s fiction novels and novellas. And you have the list. If there is anything that you would like us to eke out and save for you, we can do that. There's one here, "I love you when you're more like me." Seems like.
I did look at some of these things and I was laughing.
Published 1977.
There are a couple of titles I would have picked out.
Anyway.
Can I ask you a random question about this?
Yeah.
You know, I saw Eyes on the Prize 2 was in there, and I know there was like huge debates or legal battle over getting it on a DVD format for years that they couldn't get.
Which is that?
The Eyes on the Prize Civil Rights series. Do you know if they ever put it on DVD? Like, can teachers access it on DVD, or is it still stuck in, mired in legal battles?
I believe it's still mired in copyright issues.
Yeah.
Well, maybe we should keep that then.
That's the only thing I was looking at, because it's such a great series, and I didn't know. I thought I had read that maybe Eyes on the Prize, it had come out on DVD, but I'm not sure. But it's such a good series that I was like, oh, maybe that's worth saving, but who knows if you can even play it anymore. I'll take it.
Okay, so Mrs. Stefan would like
Eyes
on the Prize.
We'll deliver it.
Anyway, okay. Or you should keep it in case, but in case anyone wants, I don't know.
We'll put it in glass case and dedicate it to you.
Sell it on eBay.
Is that a weird request? I don't know if anyone uses it anymore. I know I loved
it. I like
it.
That you were able to pick it up.
Okay. I had fun reading through these. I love
that's
going to library sales. I'm a geek.
Okay.
So just for my curiosity, when we dispose of these, where do we dispose of them?
I have a feeling that these are going to the mighty dumpster.
Yeah,
it costs more to send them anywhere than.
Yeah, my experience is that the cost of shipping paper is so high. My intention would be, and I don't know what we've done in the past, is to contact the local library to see if they have an interest in any of these for their collection.
Yeah.
Other than that,
well, isn't there gut books or something
yes.
that come and they pick up?
Yeah, we can do that.
And there's a book collection box.
There are also
yeah.
homeless shelters.
I know that this is a lot.
Places to deliver them. However, many of these, it's important to know that paper have a shelf life. So many of them have that kind of moldy kind of set
mm-hmm.
to them. So we have to be really careful.
Uh-huh.
Particularly if there are some of them that are quite old.
Mm-hmm.
I'd be a little bit hesitant.
Pass our mold along.
It's smart mold.
It's intelligent mold, but
yeah.
regardless. It still has the must and the
yeah.
collection.
Okay. Any other questions? Okay, so could I have a motion to allow John to dispose of library books and materials that are no longer needed?
So moved.
Do you have a second?
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye.
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 Aye. Aye. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
I'm sure that we will probably have another of these lists at some point. Exciting move. We have two visitors, Laura Humphrey and Anne Tomei, who have some very exciting proposals to give you on April Vacation 2018. So I ask that they present their case.
Hi.
Hi.
I'm Laura Humphrey. This is Anne Tomei. I teach AP Statistics and Mathematics at the high school. And Anne and I have run several trips together before. And we're coming before you today to get approval for two trips, actually. One in April of next year, April of 2018, and one in April of 2019.
Okay. I was confused because they both say 18.
I know. I think I messed that up.
That's okay.
Yes, and the first one to Belize should be 2018,
yep.
And the second one should be 2019.
Okay, great.
And the reason we're doing it that way is because we are very, very excited about that Machu Picchu trip, but it took a lot of time and effort. It's taken us about a year to choose an organization to go through for that kind of adventure because we really wanted something. We like to do a trip that isn't so much a tour, but is more an adventure learning opportunity, and experiential learning, and we want to include community service and hiking and adventure travel and something cultural. And so it took us a long time to figure out who we were gonna go with that trip. And it's a National Geographic, G Expeditions is a branch of National Geographic that does small group tours and school tours. So although they don't have a big presence in the school tour business, they were the first people, National Geographic, to do tours in South America anywhere. And one of the first ones to do tours in Peru in particular. So we're very excited about going with them. But a trip of that magnitude really requires families and students to have a little bit more time to think about if they're going to attend and to save up if that's what they so desire. It's more expensive for something like that. And so that's why that's for 2 years from now. But then we haven't done a trip in 3 years. So these students who are going to be seniors next year are like, when are you having one of your trips? You know, we want to go on one of these adventure travel experiences. So for them, primarily, not that only seniors will be able to go, but to fill that niche that it's not that we didn't go anywhere during their time in high school. We propose the trip for next year, which is to Belize through Izzy Belize. And that is the same trip Ann and I took 28 students on 3 years ago for April Vacation. And it was just fabulous. Cohasset has a long-term relationship with Izzy Belize. Mm-hmm. Ann and I have run trips with them, and Dave Magnuson, when he was here, ran several trips through them. They're right out of Massachusetts, a great organization. Everyone, we just had a fabulous experience with them. And so that's like a standard and true, not a lot of work that we have to do for a huge return for the students. We know it will be a great experience for them. So that's why we're proposing that for next year, and then Machu Picchu the following year. Can I answer any questions for anyone else?
Questions? Yeah. It's open to grades 9 through 12?
Yes.
Yep. And what's the maximum number of kids you can take?
We have no maximum number. Well, I guess we do have a maximum number in a sense. We could do two buses full of kids for Belize, which means, so we're limited by bus transportation.
Okay.
So Anne would be on one bus, and I would be on the other bus, so that people who have had this experience before, there'll be at least one of us on each bus. And each bus, I think, holds like 32 people. So I guess the limit there would be 64. I would be shocked
okay.
if we got so many people.
This
we
would
never
be
had
the,
such a big group.
If we went on this trip next year, this would be the fifth time I'm doing it.
Mm-hmm.
And I've never had more than 27.
Yeah.
Okay.
Just so you know.
But
okay.
they
right.
say the limit, the housing isn't the limit, it's the bus.
It's
that's
the buses,
the limit.
Right.
And you guys are used to that, right? Transportation.
Yeah.
a lot of
yeah.
And for
Before we move on, and getting to your question, Ellen, about numbers. You know, it's interesting, these trips, because they originally were very much science curricular trips.
Mm-hmm.
That has shifted.
Mm-hmm.
It's really more field experiential and adventure.
Mm-hmm.
But with people like us, it's going to be science experiential.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's going to
yeah.
be a lot of curricular pieces,
mm-hmm.
even though it's not necessarily part of our science curriculum.
Right.
So that attracts a certain style
type
of student.
Yeah.
Right. And didn't you add statistics to it three
we
years
oh, yeah.
ago?
Oh,
yeah.
We went to Costa Rica.
And you did
we went to Costa
Rica, Costa
Rica yeah.
and you did the turtles. And
yes,
the,
exactly.
And
yeah,
the
exactly.
Yeah. There was no opportunity to do that in Belize. We were hoping to do that when we went to Belize,
mm-hmm.
too, because Boston University is usually there.
There's a lot there.
But for some reason, they didn't have any graduate students there in their
yeah.
lab the week that we were there.
Yeah.
They had just left the week before, and they were coming back 2 weeks later. But when we had signed up, everyone expected them to be there. They were... I don't know, for whatever reason, they weren't there, but they were supposed to be there. But we did go to the National Geographic's research, the Smithsonian's research island.
Oh,
and
right.
They gave us a tour, and there was this guy there. What was he studying here? Like bugs, some kind of bug that's in the ocean, and he's gone all over the world looking at this. It's kind of like a crustacean, it has a shell. It's kind of like a snail. Anyways, he's studying these bugs all over the place, and he had pictures of them. He had them in the electron microscope. He had them in the freezer. He let the kids do. It was just totally cool.
Yeah.
Oh, they were picking through bugs outside.
Yeah.
Did you have lunch with this guy?
Yeah, we stayed there. We went there for the whole day. It was really
he
awesome.
He didn't do any local bread.
I don't know if I ate any bugs. They were delicious. Everything we ate there was delicious. And for the National Geographic trip, he didn't say there was a space limitation. I asked him what the group limitation was. I said, you know, we usually have about 30 kids. That would be the most I would expect. And he didn't feel like there was a problem with that.
Mm-hmm.
But I didn't ask, what's the limiting factor? And they just add more tour guides the more people you get.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a ton of hotels in Couscous where we're going. And so he didn't seem concerned about, he's like, the more people, the better.
Yeah.
I think they'll just be excited for that. There was no transportation issue there.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
I guess the one question I had about the Peru trip, and I appreciate the effort it takes to get to Machu Picchu. It looks like it's an 11-day trip, which means that students are going to miss how many days of school?
Well, we don't know. If the calendar for that year isn't out yet.
Mm-hmm.
Good Friday that year is the 19th, so I don't know if April vacation will be that week of the 19th or
it's
usually won't
centered
be that.
Around Patriots Day, which is the 19th.
Which is probably
the
Patriots Day.
So
that would be 10 days.
Okay.
If, you know, because Friday would already be off, we might have to leave. We would be leaving probably on Thursday, the same as this last trip did. International flights usually are in the evening, but to South America, sometimes they leave in the afternoon because we go to Texas first and then fly from there. So the most I would think would be maybe Thursday, maybe a couple of classes on Thursday, but maybe not if we can get a later flight. Again, planning so far in advance will give us a little bit more flexibility with flight availability.
But it's interesting that you pick up on that, Katie, because Belize we can do in a week.
Yeah.
But with the elevation changes from Lima to Machu Picchu, you have to go through Couscous and spend a day and a half or 2 days there in order to acclimatize yourself to the elevation.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why you can't get anything for less than 11 days for that one that we're able to find.
That would be missing 4 days right before AP exams.
Oh, so you're checking. So does it turn out?
Why would we? Oh,
well, you'd be
if
going.
It's not vacation week?
If it's the 19th, if vacation week is from the 22nd to the 26th.
And the 19th is Good Friday.
Right.
So we have 19th off possibly if you schedule it that way. So we could leave Thursday.
You would miss 2 days. Okay.
Hopefully just one day.
One day, the
26th.
So
yeah.
I see.
I mean, we know that that's critically important to minimize.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Critically important to minimize, and it's been a hot button issue in the past with families around
exams and sports,
mm-hmm. and just the fact that we've had large populations of students gone and then not.
Well, and faculty out.
And faculty out, and then not being appropriate coverage for the remaining students.
Well,
and
I don't
so
think we would miss any more than what they just missed this April vacation.
So that would be a half a day.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
We would try to shoot for that.
And we'll try to shoot for missing nothing.
Right.
I mean, that's always been our goal.
Right.
One time we had to miss last period because of just the lateness that we booked the trip. We couldn't get everybody on the same flight except to leave at a flight that left at 3 o'clock. But we really do try to do that.
Fun fact for you, Cusco's 10,800 feet elevation, and Machu Picchu is 8,040, and Lima is 5,080. I didn't realize Lima was that low, and I didn't know Cusco was that high.
Yeah.
Wow.
10,000, that's going to be a headache.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, that's why, because we're aware, we're aware of the concerns. So when we were working with National Geographic and other people that we
contribute to see if we, you know, we all, we kept saying, we gotta cut it down, we gotta cut it down, and came back to that.
Oh, no, I spent a couple of months in Bolivia, and yeah, got to 12,000, 13,000 feet, and it was horrible.
Yeah. Oh, why do we put ourselves
anyway.
In
there? No.
Because don't talk around it, and I can't.
Honestly, just sip water. That's always.
Yes. Well, it's not about us. It's not about us. It's about the kids.
Yeah.
No,
he's been telling us a lot.
That was higher than 10,000. I was great at 10,000.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Good.
No.
Good job.
So actually, yeah, totally.
You were older then.
Younger than that now.
Yeah. Okay. Does anyone have any more comments? No.
No.
All right. Then we need a vote. So do I have a motion to approve, and we'll do them separately. Do I have a motion to approve the IZE Belize April Vacation 2018 trip?
So moved.
Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor, roll call please.
Aye, Barbara Steffen.
Aye, Katie Dugan.
Aye, Jean Estino.
Aye, Ellen Moore.
Aye, Amanda Zine.
Okay. And then if you could correct your copies to reflect 2019.
I'm sorry about that.
No, that's okay.
It's down
I
looked at
it. It's right down below.
Yeah.
So do I have a motion to approve April Vacation 2019 trip to Peru, Machu Picchu, and the Amazon with National Geographic Adventures?
So moved.
I'll second.
All in favor, roll call please.
Aye, Barbara Steffen.
Aye, Katie Dugan.
Aye, Jean Estino.
Aye, Ellen Moore.
Hi, Amanda.
And I know somebody who is going to be very upset that she can't go to Machu Picchu.
I know, but
because she's been talking about it for 4 years. But she'll already be gone.
Yeah.
So.
I
chose to
go to lots of great places.
Yeah.
She can go study
abroad, right?
Yeah.
You've made me feel much, much better about somebody in my household doing something like that in Ecuador very soon.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Yeah. Somebody come to you and say, tell me she's okay. Please.
Oh,
she's
going
to be great. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you guys so much.
And if anything changes along the way, just let us know.
Yeah, we'll send you our travel details.
Okay.
And then
thanks.
You can all follow the TripCast. It's so much fun. You follow Jim's TripCast. It was really fun. I'll make sure I send it to you.
Okay, great.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you.
You got it.
All right.
More excitement. Yes. We have, as our honored guest for Try It tonight, Beth Owen Rigby, who kindergarten in that digital literacy that we've been talking about all year. So thank you for taking time.
Thank you.
I had the opportunity to come and see Beth work with her kindergarten kiddos on this. Mm-hmm. And went back to it and said, oh, you've got to come and show other people.
I actually said you're on the agenda.
Because it's fun to see how you're incorporating the technology into that age bracket.
So. Yes, thank you so much for giving me the opportunity to do that. Using technology in the early childhood years doesn't seem to be as smooth of a fit as maybe some of the older grades, but we are working very hard in the early childhood years to make this work. So I created this interactive map following our Google Day last October. I went to a Google Drawing workshop that was led by Sue Skiber, and Sue presented us with this map. And I've changed it a bit, but it was a map that included links to text. And I started to think about how I could use this in my classroom. We have our Scott Forsman Reading Street program that has so many rich book of the week selections that really allow us to dig deeper and make connections to the science standards, the social studies standards, of course, Writing Center, and so forth. And each book comes with an essential question. And I began to think about how I would typically use a map, well, in the past. You know, it looked like picking up a globe and turning it to show my students, or pulling down a map from the wall back in the day.
Yeah.
And of course, as technology was introduced into the classroom, it became a digital image of a map. And I know for myself as a reader, I always want to know more about places and the people that I'm reading about. And as a teacher, I want to give my students the tools to be able to find out the answers to those questions themselves. So the idea for the map came to me fairly quickly because of those rich selections in the Reading Street program. I began to sort of focus in on the stories where I would pull out a map and show my students where the animals or the characters in the book are located in relation to us. It's an early childhood concept of geography. And so when I followed the links on the template that Sue had provided, it had text. And for my kindergarten students who are beginning readers, I realized this was not going to work. But that it would be a really amazing opportunity for the children to be able to read, have their book of the week read aloud to them, and then suddenly bring that to life through video. So I went in search of some video that would really help the children to improve their comprehension of the book of the week selection, help to build their vocabulary, and provide some inspiration for the accompanying activities that I had planned in the dramatic play area, the building area, the writing center, and the science center. So that was the idea behind the map. So I was wondering if I could just maybe show a quick little peek at a couple
of
things.
Sure.
Okay.
I'm dying to know what's the link.
I'm just going to go back to the map for just a minute. I wanted to show you where we are. So this book of the week is called Little Panda. This is actually the one Sue saw when she came. It's an informational text about the birth of the first baby panda in captivity in the United States at the San Diego Zoo. And I found a video that shows the growth of the baby pandas over the first year of their life. That's one of the main ideas of the book. And in addition, this video provided inspiration for my students for the writing center, for the dramatic play area where I had set up a center for the children to be able to imagine themselves as zoo veterinarians and zoo staff taking care of baby animals, as well as the science center where the children were working on the standard of how do animals move, because that's, again, another main idea of the book is watching how the baby pandas learn how to move during the first year of their life.
I like that.
The video goes on, you can hear some of the staff talking about their examination. You can hear the sound that the pandas make, which of course you cannot hear when you read the book of the week to your class.
Right.
So I think you can see that it's very affecting and enriching for the children to be able to experience all that's going on here at the San Diego Zoo. It's actually quite a few, it's about 6 minutes long, so I thought
as much as we would love to.
I know. I know, because they're really adorable too.
If you do YouTube in San Diego Zoo, you'll find it.
You'll actually find a lot of clips.
Okay.
Yes, that would be one of them. Okay, so and I'll just show you maybe one more if that's okay.
Yeah.
So another recent book of the week was this book called If You Could Go to Antarctica. And it is, the purpose of the book is for the children to imagine themselves taking this journey like a scientist to Antarctica. And through the beautiful photographs in the book, the children are exposed to the landscape, the uniqueness of the continent, the snow, the ice, the waves, and all the amazing animals that live there. And again, many links, of course, to the writing center, the social studies dramatic play area where children were planning a trip to the Antarctic and deciding what to pack and what they would need, and also imagining themselves in the writing center as a scientist and explorer going on a trip to the Antarctic. So this was a piece that I found to enrich and inspire. I'm just going to skip ahead just a teeny bit.
We're on an expedition to planet. expedition to Antarctica, the great white continent at the bottom of the earth. Each summer, the ice releases its grip on the continent and hardy expedition ships are able to make the voyage south.
Welcome to Antarctica.
Everything we expected and more.
Glaciers and icebergs and mountains.
There's absolutely no place that I've ever been that matches Antarctica.
I've been coming to Antarctica for 15 years. I still can't quite put it into words why I fell in love with this great white continent, but it is one of the most amazing places on the planet.
Every voyage to the Antarctic is different. We have complete flexibility to explore based on the weather and the ice. We have our zodiacs, which allow us to land wherever we choose.
We are currently exploring the Weddell Sea, and we are on Devil's Island. How do you articulate a place this beautiful? It is pretty much beyond words.
So again, the video goes on for a little while. I don't want to use up all of your time, but I just wanted to share that with you. And in the Writing Center, the children were invited to imagine that they were an explorer going on a trip and to draw and write about what they would love to see if they were able to take a trip like this. So it was, I've been very happy with my experiment of this map, and I've shared it with my other kindergarten teacher colleagues so that all the children in kindergarten have access to the enrichment. So thank you very much for
that's
great.
Great.
Yeah.
Thank you.
That's awesome. Thank you so much.
I think the wheels were turning back there. They were excitedly talking to each other about Antarctica.
More than 11 days, we said.
Yeah. More than 11 days.
Sorry. Maybe in the summer.
It's an issue, yeah.
No, it's winter.
Oh, that's right. It's the winter.
Yeah.
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 Christmas.
Winter break. I'm time it over winter break.
When it's the long one.
Thank you very much.
Oh,
Yes, she has. She said, pick me, pick me. Is it
yeah.
my turn yet?
Oh, wait, I left my glasses.
So,
I can't
update.
Even pretend anymore.
So, Mary Buchanan, Director of Student Services.
John will never get my title right. He just calls you. So I did an update like we had done earlier in the year. I had done that back in, the last one I did was back in February, I think right before the February break. So I took and just went through our district-wide positions. They're all the same. It's myself, two team chair people. We have a BCBA, a physical therapist, and one administrative assistant. So those are the people that are district-wide. Currently at the Osgood School, we've got 41 students that are on IEPs, the same number that we had back in February.
Yeah.
So not the same kids, there will be evaluations and things that are happening, but we still have approximately the same number of students. We still have one preschool teacher with two teaching an AM and a PM section of Lunch Bunch. Michelle Curtin does Lunch Bunch and she does the STARS program. We have two inclusion special ed teachers that are doing a kindergarten and grade one, and then grade two. As much as we have 41 students there on IEPs, we have only 18 students in K-1 and 2 that are receiving academic special ed instruction. So I know that all the other schools have at least one special ed teacher per grade, but I didn't want you to think that the numbers were just sort of really skewed.
So there are 18 students in that K-1 and 2.
So it's sort of speech, OT, those kind
yeah,
of
so we have 15 students that are receiving just related services, and then the balance of that is in the pre-K.
Okay.
Did you want to
answer? The STARS program, just trying to understand, is that just pre-K or is
no.
that?
No. So the STARS program are for children that have been identified with a communication delay. There's a whole criteria for what we're doing in order for students to go in there. There's a BCBA that does behavioral assessment. Typically, it's demonstrated with poor communication skills, poor communication, poor social skills, and then they're requiring a lot more instruction outside of the general ed setting.
So they stay with the same instructors while they're at Osgoode?
No. So all of our students at Osgoode are considered full inclusion students, which means that they're in the general ed classroom for at least 80% of the day.
Okay.
So as much as full inclusion, you can still pull students out for some academic instruction. So these students would be right on that cusp of being considered full inclusion to partial inclusion. So they're getting, the only academics they would be getting outside of the classroom would be possibly English or math.
Okay.
They all have a BCBA or behavior components where we're doing direct teaching on identified skills. And that's targeted and tracked with using an iPad with an ESP that would be guiding that instruction under the guidance of our BCBA.
So the students that are in the STARS program now at Osgoode, would
mm-hmm.
that continue with them when they get to Deer Hill, or
so
does
we
transition to something else?
So we try not to track students. Just because you're in one program at one school doesn't mean that you would stay. Doesn't mean that you would go from, Michelle Curtin's STARS program
right.
up to somebody at Deer Hill, and then somebody to the middle school, and then to high school track. So every 3 years we reevaluate and we determine their level of need.
Okay.
And then based upon their level of need, then we'll decide placement. Placement's always the last thing that happens at an IEP meeting. So you talk about, every year you sit and you talk about what the services that the student needs and what the accommodations are. And then we would set up who the correct contact person for special ed would be.
Right, okay.
But it's not, we don't track, we don't say that somebody goes from here to there. A lot of times students that need a partial inclusion program will stay in that, but it doesn't mean that, like when I was in high school, it's like you had, honors kids or you had shop kids or things like that. So
right.
it's reviewed on a yearly basis.
Right, right. Okay.
And then we have the special ed, the other two special ed teachers that are at the kindergarten and kindergarten, first grade, and then second grade.
Mm-hmm.
And then the related services, we have two providers that are there providing OT speech, and then our physical therapist also has a lot of students on her caseload there. Go ahead, I'm sorry.
So the two regular SPED teachers, you got Lauren Winters and who's the other one?
Sarah Cucina.
Sarah. So do they swing, do they do all three grades, or does one kind of focus on, like?
So right this year, based upon the number, based upon the kids on their caseload,
right.
Laurie Winter has kindergarten and first grade.
Okay.
And Sarah has second grade.
Gotcha, okay.
But if we have kids that require more services, then, just because it's one person, and they're a great team, they work well together. But right now that's the way it's set up.
Gotcha.
We actually, at our staff meeting on Monday, we were talking about sort of what the numbers would look like for next year.
Okay.
So we look at that, and with Laurie Dolan, we'll also do that as well with Lisa, and we'll talk about
right.
what the needs are for the program.
Gotcha.
And then at Deer Hill, this quarter we have 56 students on IEPs with any combination of academic, speech, OT, PT, social skills. The majority of the students at Deer Hill have academic instruction. So at the
earlier grades are a lot more kids that just have related services only. As Deer Hill, that 56, I would say there are probably 6 students of those 56 that just have related services. So those are students in grades 3, 4, and 5. We have the ILC, and that those 56 are students that are full inclusion within the general ed setting, and they may have a little bit of pullout services. And then we have the ILC program, which has children that are in a partial inclusion program. So they spend more than 20% of their day outside of the general ed setting. We have 3 special ed teachers in each of the grade levels, and then 1 that is the ILC that will have students in grades 3, 4, and 5. And again, we have got 1 speech therapist there, 1 school adjustment counselor, a 0.6 occupational therapist, and the school psychologist is shared between Deer Hill and Osgood. And then at Cohasset Middle High School, there are 45 students at the middle school level and 60 students at the high school level. The majority, I think we may have 1 or 2 students at each grade level, at the middle or the high school, that only have related services. So all of those IEPs are truly academic in nature. And there we've got our language-based program, which typically is for students that have average to above average cognitive abilities, and then they've got some significant deficits in their reading, writing, and sort of communication. And we provide English instruction outside of the classroom, skills support outside of the classroom, math. Our hope is next year to have those students that are in this program in our co-taught 6th grade math class that are coming up. We've got the Intermediate Learning Center, and that's a partial inclusion program. The students that are in there are outside of the general ed classroom for at least more than 20% of their day.
Okay.
So that typically, inclusion, anything more than like an hour and 15 minutes a day, those students are then starting to become partial inclusion students. We have the AIMS. Actually, the Learning Center is where they'd just be they'd be receiving some academic instruction. I'm sorry, I flipped those around.
Yep.
And then the AIMS program of the students that are outside of the general education classroom for more than 20% of their day. Right now at the middle school and high school, we've got 5 special ed teachers. And we've got 1 speech therapist that does grades 6 through 12, 2 school adjustment counselors. We have somebody right now that is providing 0.1 at the middle high school. Most of the students, when they get up to the middle high school level, are more with a consult rather than direct instruction. So that's why the numbers are lower there. And then just a summary of special education. We've got 202 students in district placements. We've got 16 students in out-of-district placements. That's a combination of collaborative placements and private school placements. And that, again, could be a collaborative, a private day school student, or a residential student. And then, so the total number in special ed are 218. Our special ed percentages are 13.7. State average is 17. And our out-of-district percentages are less than 1%. So then just a summary so our team chairs run all initial and reevaluation team meetings. They also chair all of the meetings that would be transitioned. So students that are going from 2nd to 3rd or 5th to 6th or 8th to 9th grade. So those transition years, they will also chair those team meetings. So this year, up until Monday, we had had 36 requests for initial evaluations.
So that's year to date?
Year to date.
Okay, gotcha.
19 students have been found eligible on those initial evaluations. So about 53% have been found eligible that have been referred either by a parent or the school.
Is that 19 part of the 202?
Yes.
Okay.
Actually, it may or may not be. So somebody can be found eligible
for special education services. And so as of Monday, those were the numbers. Not all of those initial IEPs have been signed.
Mm-hmm.
We have meetings that we've held back, initial evaluations that we held back in October or November, and those still haven't been signed. So we as the school district have found them eligible for special education services, but unless a parent signs the IEP, they're not technically a special ed student.
Yep.
So they have all the protections of a special ed student because we've identified them as that, but they don't receive any services or count as a special ed student until that's signed. So these numbers were hard numbers as of Monday.
Yep.
Actually, they were as of, I did it right over vacation, so it would have been as of Monday morning.
So some of the 19 could be part of the 202 because they've been signed. And
so, yes, correct.
Yep. And then the others are still in the process.
Yes.
So say 10 have been signed, 9 are outstanding, then the 202 number could grow at the next report.
It could definitely grow.
Okay.
And we still have meetings. So we have, Mike Hogan told me today, we've got 37 days left of school.
Yeah.
And so from a special ed perspective, when a parent signs an evaluation to complete, when a parent signs an evaluation consent form, the school district has 30 school days to complete that evaluation. So we still, anybody that's coming in through next Friday, we would be evaluating them this year.
Mm-hmm.
Anybody that comes in after that, the second week of May, they may be evaluated this year, but the dates roll over until September.
Gotcha.
Right.
They wouldn't change their whole plan for the last 30 days of school.
Right. Even, whether it's a reevaluation or an initial evaluation. And then so once the evaluation is signed, we have 45 school days to conduct an IEP team meeting and give the parent the IEP. So those numbers will always stay, it's as fluid as, parent signing.
And those
the
are
IEPs.
The school days, 45 school days.
Yes.
Yeah, not
200. Not vacation or weekends.
Okay. Because it struck me in reading it that, so this whole process is going on, and so 45 days is essentially 9 school weeks,
mm-hmm.
right? So this child who may or may not need services is kind of in limbo.
Yeah, not getting the services.
Not getting the services.
Exactly.
And it has nothing to do with you or your team. It's just the process.
Well, it's the federal and state regulations. We'll have, because if you think about it, some of these students, if you have cognitive testing, say you're a fifth or sixth grade student, when somebody's in pre-kindergarten, if they're just having academic cognitive testing, that may be 45 minutes. But if you have somebody that's in seventh or eighth grade, you're talking about 2 hours of cognitive testing. You're talking about another 2 hours of academic testing.
Mm-hmm.
If they're having speech, that's another 2 hours.
Mm-hmm.
You have to sprinkle that in, right?
Oh, yeah.
Amongst, so you're not pulling them out
take them out for days.
And parents are very specific about, I don't want them taken out of their English class. I don't want them taken out of this. So the evaluators are also doing observations. The general ed teachers are also collecting data, so that's all part of the initial team meeting.
Yeah.
So it really seems long when there are vacation days put in there, and then snow days.
Right.
So if we have a snow day, it rolls back, like we rolled back 4 days.
Mm-hmm.
We try to conduct those meetings, but that's part of the process.
Mm-hmm.
The number of reevaluations. So every 3 years, you must conduct an evaluation to determine whether somebody is eligible. So we've had 57 3-year reevaluations this year. Of those, 43 have been found eligible at a reevaluation, and 14 have been found not eligible. So about 75% of our students that are reevaluated are found eligible for special education again.
So what would cause them to no longer be eligible?
So
am I hearing that right? That they're no longer. Okay.
Yes.
So
they've
received services and they've progressed to the level that their expectation for performance at
mm-hmm.
that grade? an age?
Yeah, so a lot of times, you know, especially at the young age, students may be found eligible for, say, communication
right.
or articulation
yeah.
or something along those lines. Our hope is that we're remediating. I mean, that's the goal, that we're trying to get the kids back into the general ed setting. The other thing is that once a student turns 9 years of age, up until 9 years of age, so from the time they're three until the time of their ninth birthday, they can be found eligible under a developmental delay. And that developmental delay is kind of a catch-all.
Mm-hmm.
It's sort of, you can really sort of, you know, it's very wiggly,
yeah.
for lack of a technical term. Once somebody turns 9 years old, there has to be an identified disability. So
mm-hmm.
whether it's, there are 9 categories in Massachusetts,
yeah.
but that developmental delay, which is sort of that catch-all at the younger age, no longer applies.
I guess my confusion was, it's 57
3-year
reevaluations across all grade levels.
From, right.
Okay,
yeah.
all right.
So,
because I was looking at it thinking middle to high school, 57.
So you'd have different kids on a different cycle.
Right.
Yeah.
Yes, thank God.
First
yeah.
The other thing you could be doing is moving them to a 504, so they maybe don't need the intensity of an IEP.
you could.
With the services on an IEP, but
mm-hmm.
maybe need accommodations. Does that happen a lot?
It does happen, you know, if you go to any presentation by an attorney, they'll say that, you know, the IEP is not varsity and, you know, the 504 is not JV. You know, one you sort of
right.
go from one to the other.
It has nothing to do with the other,
right.
necessarily.
But on both of those, you'd still need an identified disability. Those numbers still don't reflect whether or not somebody's gone to from a IEP
right.
onto a 504.
I'm just like, it seemed like your question was sort of like, oh, they're just dropped cold, but they're not, that's not, maybe that's
no, it's not, I mean, it's really a collaborative process,
mm-hmm.
and parents with a reevaluation always have the ability with the stay put.
Yeah.
So
mm-hmm.
if you evaluate a student and they no longer are presenting with a disability, then, you know, the school can say that they're not eligible, but the parents still can say, you know what, I disagree with that finding. And the students have the stay put right, so they're eligible to the same services as that. The other thing is, a lot of times younger students may have a health disability, which would have ADHD, and sometimes if students become or start taking medication, those deficits are then closed. There are lots of reasons why somebody with a reevaluation may not be found eligible again. And then there were 43 students found eligible, and then 14 that were found not eligible. So that's sort of the stats regarding special ed. I'm not sure who had suggested it. We've been working on the second piece that you have, the process and programming. It's still a work in progress. So how I'm actually going to put this up on the webpage, I'm going to separate it into two parts. So we'll have the process, that'll be the first 7 pages, and then we'll separate that so that the programming is the second section. So somebody, if they just want to start to look at the process of special education, they can do that. So using the, you know, the Massachusetts regulations and federal regulations, we put this together, so hopefully it's a roadmap for parents. Because it really is confusing, whether you're a preschool age or you're a parent of, you know, an 11th grader.
I thought, Mary, it was really great how you included not only, like, the process of going through the IEP, but also for parents that do have students in special education
mm-hmm.
to understand what's available as they get older, like, what
yeah.
their programming now could transition to if they're considered still eligible
mm-hmm.
as they move through
yeah.
the system. So.
Definitely easy to read and make
oh, good.
Sense.
Yes.
Like
yeah.
sometimes you read stuff and you're like, oh,
it
but
really,
this really
I,
made sense
yeah.
and didn't seem
yeah.
intimidating.
It wasn't
yeah.
After this, not like next week, but after this,
yeah.
I'd like to do the same thing with Section 504
mm-hmm.
so that parents can understand what that is as well.
That's great because, man, that's a.
Yeah.
That's confusing for people.
It is.
People think that if. They think that 504 is special education.
Right.
It's really not.
Right.
So, and it takes a long time for people to get it, that just, you know, maybe the child just needs help with the locker with the executive functioning, or maybe they need to be able to leave the room 5 minutes before everyone else because they're uncomfortable with mass exit at the door.
Right.
You know, there are all different kinds of accommodations that can be handled with a 504. So I think that it's great. I personally appreciate this. We get cross-examined by people out and about
mm-hmm.
about, well, how many students are on special ed? We've been told we can't know. There are no names here. It's
right.
just helpful for us to understand
large
exactly what's going on and how things are being addressed.
Mm-hmm.
So thank you for putting this together.
Yes, Barbara.
Yes.
So I just had, not necessarily for this meeting, but because it might not be the appropriate time, but I was just kind of curious about disability categories, if there's big enough lumpings, if that gets broken
isn't.
Down.
I think if you go onto DESE website, you can, those that information is in there, but
okay.
it's not, it's a few years old.
Yeah.
At the end of the year, we can run reports. I can give percentages. I wouldn't want to give exact numbers.
No, I don't
because
think that. It's just kind of like even the two major, like, or the most, like, I mean, when you mentioned middle high school, it said it's primary, a lot of language-based deficits.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, that's just the kind of information that's interesting. I mean, to me, just to kind of know, like, what is the largest service that we are providing? Or is there a service that, like, 50% of the students that are on IEPs that we need to address? I'm just, that's what I'm curious about.
So I can say, and I've had staff meetings at the three buildings this week, and my topic has been executive functioning, which will segue in May 22nd.
Right.
Sarah Ward is presenting at Deerfield School. If you haven't seen her, she's fabulous. Honestly, from a kindergarten, pre-K level, all the way through, you know, adults. She's got some great strategies, and I brought these handouts. We don't have a lot of participants. It went out on Blackboard
yep.
as well tonight. But if you get a chance to see her, she's presenting at Deer Hill on the 22nd of May from 7 to 9. She really is.
Yep. It's got
she's presented here. I think maybe some of you have seen her.
I haven't,
but
I know
the
that
teachers
she's
have absolutely.
She
taken.
Did opening day, I think, 4 years ago.
And yes, and then she did another full day PD, I think.
But it hasn't been since I've been here.
Before that, I think.
Yeah.
And teachers have adopted some of her techniques, her time clock, and many of her presentations were concrete as to what executive functioning is and why they need it. So it's beyond compare, and if anything is, as most of the programs for CPAC have been this year, this is stellar. It's really encouraging to have parents of whether it's a student on IEP or not, whether it's a teenager, it's a really good place to go to just get some great ideas.
And what's nice about her is, you know, her strategies are developmentally appropriate right from, you know, kindergarten all the way through, you know, college students. She does a lot of work with counseling college students, and it's really neat to sort of watch her dissect how long kids think something's going to take. You know,
yeah.
And it's just interesting, and sort of the time management, and just sort of she really gives kids a reality check.
Mm-hmm.
So it's been interesting. So we talked a lot about that. Our staff meetings this year at the middle high school, there were a group of us that went to the landmark executive functioning workshop at Cape Cod last summer. And everybody has had the challenge of, all the teachers have had the opportunity to present different strategies that they're using. So it's really been great. Maureen Berry just read a book that just came out, and I just ordered it on Amazon today. It's called Make Your Bed, and it's from an ex-Navy SEAL sergeant, and he sort of talks about just doing one small thing at the beginning of the day sort of sets your priorities. It was really good. The book's $11.95, but I just you know, she read an excerpt from it today. It's really good.
That's totally true. I'd like
yeah.
to
May
Yeah, you know, and it, so, you know, he talks about, you know, I kind of, I signed up, I became this Navy SEAL, I thought I was going to be this, you know, big time, you know, hero, and here I am every morning, I have to make my bed with, you know, four corners, and, you know, the coin has to drop off of it, but he gave some nice strategies, and she's been working with some of the high school boys, and they really are relating to it, so if you get a chance to read it, the excerpts that she read today were great. So at the middle high school level, they've been presenting to their peers and it's their colleagues, and it's been great. So that executive functioning is something that organization right from a kindergarten level all the way through high school is one of the things that we see.
Mm-hmm.
I think we're really doing a great job with our, you know, universal design and our differentiated instruction. So I think a lot of the specific learning disabilities, I think those numbers are coming down over the past 5 or 6 years, because there's more general ed instruction that is meeting the needs of kids.
Right.
And I think health has really gone up. So that those would be sort of the areas.
I just know like the national disability categories, like I don't have them, I just remember looking them up a year ago, it was like reading disabilities are the number one diagnosed, number two has been autism, which has come up a lot. And I can't remember what other, I just kind of, what I'm sort of curious to know is like, I'm assuming we match those, but I was just kind of curious how they line up.
Yeah, so we have, so the disability categories, they're on page 3 of the, and I can sort of give you a percentage if you're looking for that.
Yeah, I mean, I was just kind of curious, you know, do we sort of match national trends in the disability
I would think that our health, our communication, and then our specific learning disabilities, those would be our top three. I mean, so under the age of 9, again, developmental delay would be the big one.
Yeah.
Typically, students before 3rd grade are not being diagnosed with a specific learning disability. They're falling under the developmental delay.
So I was particularly curious, the Deer Hill middle school ones.
So I can get that information for you. I won't give you exact numbers,
That's
but I can certainly give you a percentage.
Okay. And I actually did have one other question, too.
Sure.
So that for the number, and I'm looking into numbers in other districts today, and I think I've figured out why. So the total number in SPED for your, that you have in your summary of special education students has us at 13.7%,
mm-hmm.
and the state average at 17.2%. And I was just looking on the state website, which has us at 11.4, but I'm guessing maybe, it was 2016-17 data, but I think this probably reflects your actual numbers based on our current enrollment numbers, so that, so basically I think what's up there on the state is probably not accurate, and maybe hasn't been as accurate as it could have been, because I was looking at other districts that had 11.4%, which is what we're listed on the state, or less, and there's only 10 districts outside of charter schools that have a number that low. So that, and I know there was, you know, are we under-identifying, are we on target? So the 13.7 seems to make, like, be a more target number.
Because it's a very current. State data is sometimes too often more, almost 3 years old.
Yeah, this one, I mean, I don't know if they've, some of their data was from 2014-15, and this was seemed more accurate than others because it said 2016-17.
So if it's reported 13-14, it's probably 12.
Yeah, okay.
And
so
reported in 13.
But from looking at these numbers, it was just interesting sort of.
Mm-hmm. The numbers that you have here are real numbers.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So they're really, you know, hard counting the IEPs in our ESPED.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it aligns with a lot of the districts. Like, I looked at Cohasset, Hingham, Harvard, Duxbury, Scituate, Wellesley, Dover, Sherburne, Dover, Sherburne, Hall, Lexington, blah, blah, blah. It, like, kind of puts us still in the low end, but sort of more in line.
I think we're also working very hard to make sure that our numbers that are in IPASS reflect what our ESPED, and we're doing that data within the district, as opposed to we had an outside person that was doing that.
Right.
So I think the number, I know the numbers that we have here are real numbers.
Yeah.
And even, you know,
it's like the numbers on everything right now, they're very accurate at the moment. Because
that's kind
we
of what I was trying to say.
It
seems
one,
like
two,
it's
two,
very
three,
accurate,
four.
And it seems like it makes more sense.
It's correct.
So that's kind of what I was getting at. So what's up there for us on the state right now, I think, is.
Well, we learned through a lot of our various benchmarking that we've done over the last two or three years that the numbers for the dates are behind.
The current numbers are very accurate.
Right. So, and that's, looks wonderful.
And thank you for the alphabet soup too.
Oh, yeah.
Ellen has a question.
I have a question slash comment, and this is an anecdote from a friend of mine who has a daughter in college and in at Cohasset. She was a very high achieving student, but suffered like stressed over exams and completing exams,
mm-hmm.
and carried that forward into college. And someone at the school said, well, why don't you get tested? Now, this is at a private college, you know, get tested because there are services for at college. And I had never heard that. And my friend said, oh my God, what a horrible mother I am. I mean, you know, this girl had an over a 4.0 GPA, and why would I think she had, you know, a learning issue? So my comment question is, are we in guidance with our juniors and seniors if they're on IEPs or have some learning issues, being counseled that parents can look for support at the college level?
So as part of transition planning, at the age of 14, we need to start talking with students about their disabilities,
mm-hmm.
and sort of next steps, whether their goal is a 2-year, 4-year, you know, competitive, you know, college, what their goals are, and that information is shared with parents at team meetings.
Okay.
IEPs do not go to college with
right.
you. They end
right.
the day that you graduate.
Right.
Colleges, you know, and it's the student's responsibility at a college level to then advocate for themselves that they have a disability and they require some additional accommodations.
I've taught at 3 different colleges, and I can say 4 actually. I can say from an instructor's point of view, the beginning of, usually when we give out the syllabus to students,
yeah.
particularly at community colleges, but also 4-year, the syllabus usually states, if you foresee difficulties in learning or you have been identified with a learning disability and would like to share it with your instructor, please do so at the end of the first class. Also, instructors are also given the viewpoint of to look for certain particular students who may be having some difficulty and to have that conversation. But there is also that privacy issue where colleges will announce that please, you know, be comfortable doing that or that kind of thing, but it doesn't follow them. So it's really at that point to act as an adult when they go to college and say, I want to advocate for myself. But do they do that in college? In high school, I know that the guidance counselors at the high school do have those conversations.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. When you go onto school, you really want to share with. And they go through the whole process on this is not going to follow you, so you must now advocate for yourself.
Mm-hmm.
What we often find, or I found particularly at the community colleges, is that parents intercept or will make it known that they want reports on their students. And instructors will give progress reports.
Mm-hmm.
So it's become more acceptable for instructors to reach out to students.
Yeah. So. Well, this student never had,
right,
was on, was never identified, never even thought, she just thought she was a stress ball and it was how she was built,
mm-hmm.
because her performance was so good. But someone at college pointed it out to her and said, oh, you can go get some services.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and my friend was like, oh my God, I'm a horrible mother.
You know? My youngest son has ADHD, and when he was taking his SATs, the first time he took them, he had said, what kind of a horrible mother are you? You advocate for people all day long getting extended time when you're college goes, and you didn't do it for me.
Yeah.
He was so mad at me. And Rick said, oh, Colin, you know, you're somebody that if I you know, fought for you to get, you know, an extra, you know, 2 or 3 hours on SATs, you would have hung me out to dry, because if you give somebody that extended time, they have to sit there for those extra 2 hours.
Right.
It's not like, wait, if you finish early, you can get up and leave.
Yeah.
So I said, you're one of those that would have stressed you out more. So we do, the guidance counselors, if somebody is on an IEP,
yeah.
Students and parents may sign for a release of records. We make copies all the time for
mm-hmm.
colleges so that their latest cognitive testing
mm-hmm.
And their IEPs will go with them, especially students that are going to schools that have like Curry College has the PALS program, which is a special ed program.
Mm-hmm.
Landmark College is one that has a lot of resources.
Mm-hmm.
So there are a lot of different schools that have those resources, so they really look for that latest cognitive testing. Wait 1 second, Barbara. I do think that sometimes when students are coming from a small high school, our teachers really do a really good job of taking care of kids, you know, at that high school level.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes when they go up to a college level, it's more difficult to, you know, navigate that independence.
Mm-hmm.
And even if you're going to a small college, I think it's really, you know, a big difference. I think we do a lot of, and I think the parents do a lot of, I think they do a lot of helping and organizing their kids because they don't want them to fail, because, not fail as in getting apps, but they want them to do well so that they can go to the next step in life.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, it's twofold. It's like, on one hand, it's, you're great because, you know, the kids have all these opportunities, and on the other hand, they don't know what it's really like to sort of, you know, fly a little bit free.
Yeah. Yeah.
So a lot of kids will have that at a college level, that that happens.
It's interesting.
It's Barbara's turn now.
Six years ago, when we were doing college choice, the first time in my family, some of the college, the students who were doing the tours talked about academic support in their schools. I remember URI was one of them.
Mm-hmm.
That the student went to great lengths to show us the building where you would go if you needed some extra help, and, you know, talk to the students to make them feel comfortable about
some
the college experience.
College funding is based on seeing students through 4 years.
Mm-hmm.
So there's federal programs such as, I know that community colleges here have it, that there is a special program for students, particularly those struggling, that if they go through the entire graduation process, that gives an increase in funding for the following year. Mm-hmm. So there's incentive.
And I, when I looked at schools, you know, most of them do have a student support center.
Yeah.
Again, it's something that the student has to access.
Right,
it's
right.
Not something that somebody says, oh, you need to go to that.
Right.
Yeah.
And that's the big difference. I mean, in high school, our students that are on IEPs, or even if you're a general ed student, you know, your teachers are sort of like, hey, you
come
know, that assignment's due.
Come see me after class.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah,
exactly. And that's not a suggestion.
Yeah.
Right, so there is a big difference with that. You know, that when my son went from a small high school, you know, his teachers would be like, I mean, come on, you know, you need to be doing this or you need to be doing that. And, you know, when you go to a huge, you know, school, it's sort of, you are a number.
Right.
And it is a big change.
Right. Wow.
Oh, I was just going to say that I think Ellen's point's interesting about a student who really didn't realize that they may have had an issue, because my niece had ADHD, went through an Ivy League school and got through fine, but it was chaotic, and it wasn't until the workforce that she was like, why is things always so chaotic? And now
mm-hmm.
she's at Yale Business School, and boy, things are going a lot more smoothly
mm-hmm.
now that she got the support she needed. But I definitely think that the support services at colleges now from 30 years ago, it's changed so much. It's part of the tour, like you
mm-hmm.
said. And
right.
also, I think a lot of counseling, if you have a questionnaire, you know, you have students fill out information about what did I like about this school. I mean, one of the things I'd always tell students is about the support services, like
mm-hmm.
what's offered, is it, you know, how extensive is it, all that kind of stuff. So it's definitely, I think they reach out a lot more to students. But
any more questions?
I just had one quick question. I thought this was awesome.
Thank you.
What, if any, of this is going to be incorporated into the student handbook? I know that we're kind of creating a district section and a school section, but when it comes to special ed, we've been dreaming of kind of a description that talks consistently, particularly between Deer Hill and Osgoode, about what is student services. So
mm-hmm.
I didn't know if your vision was to use pieces of this in the student handbook, or you're developing something separate?
So with the middle and high school handbooks
mm-hmm.
that you approved, there was a section
yes.
that was outlined for student
mm-hmm.
services in both of those that was new this year.
So that was in the program of studies.
Right.
But, and then
oh, the student handbook?
Yeah, the student handbook is something we approve in June
okay.
usually.
I think that's my question.
Okay, excellent,
yeah.
sorry.
That's okay, because, no, this would not be part of the student handbook, the parent-student handbook, particularly because it's very focused and it is specialized and it would make for a tome. It's already quite a large. However, the definitions are in there and the access to a lot of the preliminary information is there.
Okay.
And where this is going to be on the website.
That was my next question.
Tomorrow.
Well.
No, but it's going on the website tomorrow.
We would link it at some point, and I think that what we have currently as a parent, student handbook is something we want to look at and keep organic and see what we need to add to it as we go, but I think this would make it cumbersome.
I guess I totally agree that we don't need the whole thing. My only concern is that, and I've said this 2 years running, is that when you read the Osgood handbook, you read student services, and then you read the Deer Hill, it felt like you had Latin in one and Greek in the other, and the reality is that, especially when we're talking K to five, it's a pretty,
to answer your question, that will be one.
That will be one.
That will be one.
Okay.
The only things that are going to be in the Deer Hill Osgood Middle High School are things that are very specific to that school.
Okay.
So, a process for testing or anything else becomes a district.
Mm-hmm. Gotcha.
So we've separated everything that is linear to go here, and anything that is just, for example, grades, letter grades would be middle high school. Standardized grading would be both Osgood Deer Hill. So
homework
we're going to try to align
policies.
Everything so that there is no confusion on any of that information, that it really is a district information.
And then the last thing, Ellen had asked for a breakdown of the ESPs. You had said that you had shared that with staff, but these are just the, these were the, did everybody get it?
Yes,
yeah.
Thank you.
So at the high school, there are 8 ESPs, FTE of 0.7. All of those are under the budget, and there is one one-to-one ESP at the high school. At the middle school, there are 8 ESPs, 8 FTEs, 6 through the budget. Why am I off by a number?
Yeah.
Wait, I have it right here. Sorry about that. So I'm sorry, it should be 7 a budget and 1 is at the 240 grant. And then at Deer Hill, there are 7 FTEs. 2 are from budget and 5 are from the 240 grant. And there's 1 1-to-1 at Deer Hill.
Mm-hmm.
At Osgood, there are 10 special ed ESPs, 8.4 FTEs, 3 are budget, 2 are 240 grant, 1 is the 262, which is the early childhood grant, 1 is the K revolving, and 3 that equal 0.2 are from the pre-K revolving, and there are 3 one-to-ones at the Osgood. The 3 falls under the 10.
The 10,
yeah.
Gotcha. Okay.
So I hope that helps a little bit.
That's great, thank you.
Good.
Thank you.
So if I added up the FTEs, there's 30.4 FTEs for ESPs. Right, 7, 8, 15, 22, and 8 is 30.4. Thirty-four bodies, and then
34 bodies, but 30.4 FTEs.
So they're at the at the high school, there are 2 positions that are, one's a 0.8 and one's a 0.2, and then and then not until you get to Osgood, there's one that's a 0.8, there's one that's a 0.4, there's another that's a 0.8, and there's another that's a 0.4.
Right, so it's 7 FTEs at the high school, plus 8 is 15, plus 7 is 22, plus 8.4 gets us to 30.4.
Right.
Okay, 34 bodies with 30.4 FTEs. 10.
Wait, what were the FTEs at the middle school? Was that 7 or 8?
Seven.
Okay.
Oh, no, eight total.
No, eight, sorry.
Okay.
Seven in the budget and one in the 240 grant.
Oh, okay, okay, sorry.
So seven at the high school, eight at the middle school.
No, are there eight at the high, oh, I'm sorry, there are seven FTEs, yeah.
FTEs, yeah.
Yep.
Because we budget on FTEs, so seven.
Thirty.
15, 30.4, yeah.
Yeah.
Yes.
I can still do math. Okay.
Thank you, Mary.
Thank you.
Thanks, excellent job.
Thank you so much, everybody, it was great.
Especially as Mary has been struggling with a sore throat, so she's done extremely well, so she gets the award.
Yeah, I'll leave these, they'll be out in front of my office if anybody wants this award or.
Yeah, I'll take one, just stick in my calendar.
Oops, sorry.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Couple of good news. We have an enrollment update. Have that as G3 in your packet. We had three little changes in our enrollment. We have a family that has moved to Dublin, Ohio. So they had a second grader, which reduced our second grade enrollment by one. And I think there were twins in grade six. So those were the three that had left the district. And we had a youngster in grade one who's moved here from Illinois. And that's done an increase there. And we are keeping track of names, grades, and where they've gone and where they're coming from. So it's a very accurate number.
Mm-hmm.
Any questions on that?
That's great.
There is an update on the kindergarten enrollment that I did send to you,
mm-hmm.
So that we are working creatively in looking at our half day has reduced to five, which means that that does not fill a class. And Lisa's had those conversations, and we're working creatively on how to go about doing that for your, and 84 on full day at this point. Not sure what the reasons are for the change, other than some parents have decided to delay entrance into full day kindergarten and those who have shifted in and out.
Yep.
So that's our enrollment.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if you have any questions there. We're keeping very, very careful tabs.
And I think publicly the one thing that we did commit to last January was just maintaining kindergarten class
mm-hmm.
sizes less than 20. I think there were some concerns expressed about half day and full day being combined into one, but when you get down to levels of five students, it's socially not
mm-hmm.
a good
yeah.
situation.
Right.
So we have to balance the two.
We've also, Lisa, John, and I have spoken about possibilities where for days when we have early release, that we would have something creative for those half-day kiddos where they could stay for lunch and so on, which would also facilitate the bus runs.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So
yep.
we're trying to be as creative and helpful with the families of at least five as we
yep.
can.
Mm-hmm.
We don't anticipate 10. I don't think that we'd man a class, a half-day class, until we got 9 or 10. And we will communicate that early to families. So hopefully by next week, Lisa will have spoken to all five. So it's, and the teachers are aware as well.
Mm-hmm.
So they've all been, she had a meeting with the entire kindergarten staff today. So we're working. Clear anticipations, no surprises.
And just in terms of last summer, we really, our enrollment numbers did not change materially from this point out. So, I mean, knock on wood, things do happen in the summer, and there have been summers where we've seen an influx of students, but that would hit us across all grades. So we're still at 89.
Right.
And
both Jean and I have looked at the census, and even given the number that we don't have names for as registered with the number, on the census,
yeah.
we still are in a good
when
margin.
When we add those
mm-hmm.
in anticipation,
so
we're still fine.
We seem to come out in a good shape either way.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
under that
right.
that 100
yeah.
mark for five sections, hopefully.
Right.
Yeah.
So everything we could possibly do, we've done.
Okay.
So that's where we're doing right now.
All right.
So it's a good place. You also have the school calendar, and as you know, we've had some lovely storm days.
Mm-hmm.
Although it was a mild winter, those mild days weren't mild. So that we are now marking with our continued 4 days to end the year on June 23rd. It is an early release date for students,
mm-hmm.
not for staff. So our last day needs to be voted as officially being June 23rd, 2017.
Okay,
and
could I have a motion to approve June 23rd as the last day of school for the 16-17 Cohasset Public Schools calendar?
So moved.
And do I have a second?
I'll second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you very much.
If we could weave this into school newsletters,
mm-hmm.
it's still shocking to me that parents ask me whether they need to make up school days and what is the last day of school.
Since you voted on it, I anticipate putting a Blackboard Connect out.
Oh,
so
great.
I will
That'd
ask
great.
The principals to also put it in their newsletters.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you. Mm-hmm. And you can put it on the Facebook page also,
mm-hmm.
maybe.
That's true. Thank you. I will do that. Facebook and website. I wanted to give you an update on the assistant superintendent hire and give Sue and Carolyn, who have co-chaired the committee to filter through almost 60 applicants for assistant
mm-hmm.
superintendent. They've Sue finalized the committee, Sue, Carolyn, and the committee, which had about 10 people, would you say?
About.
From all factions, narrowed their, they interviewed 10 candidates, and of the 10, have recommended 4 that we're going to continue to review. We have interviews scheduled this Friday and hopefully the others next week. At that point, we need to discuss whether we're going to do school visits for them and narrow it to the lucky person who gets to work with us. Hopefully by mid-May. That's where we are. Questions on that?
I think it's a testament to the district because I know of another district who was advertising the same position and got 3.
Oh, wow. Feels so good right now.
Yes. And you all should.
Oh, that's awesome.
That's
great.
Great.
That is great, great news.
Not great for them.
No,
it's
no,
great.
No,
it's great for us. And I am sure that Sue will attest. It was difficult because there are some very qualified people who would like to come to Cohasset. So, very exciting.
I got to be on that committee. That was, it was really interesting, and I was really impressed with the candidates we got.
We did go through my tough questions.
Mm-hmm.
I tend to be quite tough. Second time. Thus it will be. But anyway, it is very exciting, and
mm-hmm.
I am very excited about this. So it'll be great. I also anticipate that, and I can say that I'm twisting Sue's arm to stay on in some capacity as well.
Mm-hmm.
So
excellent. Not too hard.
it's only a shackle around the desk. It's serious. So. And we've talked, Sue and I and Joanne McDonald started this journey together about 4 years ago, talking about what will it look like, can we do a survey, can we assess the competency of our staff, can we start with one course, and here we are.
Yeah,
so
exciting.
I can't let her go yet until we finish,
yeah.
So very excited.
You have to be here to take the victory lap.
Yes, absolutely. You know, you've certainly come a very, very long way.
And to that end, actually, I would add, we did our first MCAS computer-based testing one day before vacation, and then we've just completed 2 more this week and 1 more tomorrow. And they've gone beautifully. It has been smooth. You know, Bart and Kyle have been phenomenal in helping to get the machines up and running. Carrie Sandler did an outstanding job, and Jennifer, and getting their schools ready and the schedules, and so it's been it's really been good to see. I mean, we were all holding our breath
mm-hmm.
because
mm-hmm.
the first time we've done it, but it went very, very well, and the kids engaged totally. Barely looked up when you walked in the room.
That's great.
They were busy working.
Now the complaint I get is that my son has to write an open response longhand in handwriting versus doing it on a keyboard. So it's funny to see his reaction now.
Yeah.
I mean, he still doesn't like open response, but he likes it better when you type it.
Yeah, I do.
Exactly.
I
do the clicking of the keys.
Right.
Yeah, it's been a very pleasant revelation, but I have to say that it's because of, again, Sue's hard work with Bart and with Kyle and Ron and getting everything in place, testing it out, getting the kinks out, and reassuring the teachers, the staff, the administrator, and the children that this is okay. This is just part of the process, and I think that's what made it successful. So, yeah. Another victory lap.
That's great.
Thank you. We have a gift from, if you look at F5, they voted on, PSO voted for another Osgood grant last week, but before I share that with you, it is for Ms. DeLeo, who has submitted that, but I do want to share her very big excitement at her 15-month-old soon to be adopted Braden, who she has taken home with her today, or yesterday.
That's great.
So she's very excited. She said it is the best thing that happened to her in her whole life. So we are very, very excited. And Lisa is in the process of filtering out the applicants for a sub. She has someone who's consistent this week and hope to have somebody for the rest of the year by next week. Very optimistic, and I know that parents have concern, but we are in great shape, so we're on top of it. But you need to vote for $189 for $46 for turn in your work organizer, all-purpose teachers organizer, because we're going to get the teacher organized too, writing prompts for the bulletin board, and alphabet storage baskets for Oscar.
Okay, so could I have a motion to approve the generous PSO grant in the amount of $189 for the Osgood School, according to the outline that we have in front of us.
So moved.
Do I have a second?
I'll second.
All in favor, roll call, please.
Aye, Barbara Steffen.
Aye, Katie Dugan.
Aye, Jean Estina.
Aye, Ellen Marr.
Aye, Amanda Zani.
Item under school committee comments and communication, and if I can clarify that every year as a board member for the South Shore Educational Collaborative, for whom we are a member, you need to nominate and vote me in one more time.
Or
and I
make
do
it
accept
ourselves.
The nominee. Excellent. I don't want to say. We've got a big problem if you're not accepting the
nominee. Okay. All right. So could I have a motion to nominate Elise Demas to the South Shore Educational Collaborative Board for the upcoming year.
Can we just have a motion to appoint?
Yes.
We don't have to motion to nominate and then motion to vote?
To nominate and appoint.
Okay.
So moved.
Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
I just had one quick question. In the update to school committees, it talked about the fact that there had been proposed tuition for next year. Do you remember off the top of your head what the percent increase was?
It's minimal.
Okay.
I want to say it's under 5%. I'll have to check.
Okay.
What happened with the South Shore Collaborative is we have now voted to have two sets of tuition, one for those who are members and those who are not. So there's a slight larger increase for those who are not members. There was also an added member to the South Shore Collaborative, and that's Milton.
Yep.
So it's not huge, I have to look.
I was just curious, because we had budgeted 3% kind of across the board, and I just was curious to know how close it came in to the 3% that
we
had.
That was given after they gave me the number. I think I shared that with John before we put it in the budget.
Okay.
So it is covered.
Okay.
And it must be 3%.
I mean, we typically just, we had done our best guess in years past and it had been sufficient, I was just curious.
I think this is accurate.
Okay.
So next on the agenda is the second read of four policies. First one is policy JLC, Student Health Services and Requirements. Does anybody have any further comments on this?
I just have one comment, Jean. I did call MASC about this to ask about that question you had raised last time, Barb. And I spoke with them this week, and they said that this particular bullet point, number two, under emergency procedures, is relating to medication that students would request, like from the nurse,
yes.
Such as Tylenol or
I think
aspirin.
I called them the same day.
Oh, you did? Okay.
So I was like, should I call Amanda or should I just call Matt? And they're like, oh, someone called about the same thing earlier. I was like, I have a feeling.
I was
like,
yeah, your all school sisters working with the same thing.
I should have texted you to let you know if I had done it, but I did call and I did ask about that. So just to clarify.
I still didn't completely understand it, but I was like, if you guys have cleared it and done the legal, and the part I didn't understand, they said it related to different statutes, and I was like, okay, fine. So that would be great.
maybe that information's covered in these legal references that are listed here, but I had gotten the same response from them, so.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yep. Anybody else?
No.
Okay, so could I have a motion to approve policy JLC?
So moved.
Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Next is policy IMG, animals in school. Any comments on this?
2 days after, there was the fourth grade visit with the canine unit. I was like, you know what? We have a policy. And it was held outside the school because it was a nice day.
So it wasn't in the school.
It was not in the school.
Yeah.
Okay. So if there are no comments, do I have a motion to approve policy IMG?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Next is school admissions, which is policy JF. Any comments? Okay, so motion to approve policy JF.
So moved.
Second?
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye.
And last but not least is policy JLCD, administering medicines to students. Comments? No? Okay, can I have a motion to approve JLCD?
So moved.
Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, next on the agenda is the follow-up list, which is almost non-existent anymore.
Yes.
So that's all good.
Okay, so most of this will come off on November 1st B on the Cohasset Middle High School Parent Survey. I'll talk about that when I review school council.
Okay.
That came up.
Does anybody, I mean, there are only a couple of other things that are in process.
Yeah, I think February 15th B just got completed as we voted those policies, right? There's nothing left that we need to do related to the allergen and allergy policy protocol, right?
No, I don't think so.
Yeah.
Well, no, it's different.
The medical emergency plan.
The
medical emergency plan is different from the school committee policies.
I thought we had been talking about the policy implications. Oh, but maybe that's wrong.
Well, the medical emergency plan is like the district-wide emergency response. So the new allergy information just needs to get
incorporated.
Okay.
Yeah,
I think. Yeah, so check.
So the allergy protocol has no implications
for other policies.
At other policies. Okay.
Mm-hmm. No,
okay.
I think Amanda went. We both, I think, did searches online on the manuals, and then I also went kind of page by page through our handbook just to see if there was anything kind of missed.
Yeah.
And I think we came up with a lot of similar, like, you know, close, but no, it doesn't really apply.
Okay.
So I think we're pretty good.
Gotcha.
Okay.
Okay.
All right.
Good. The tiered support documentation is part, it will be part of the parent student handbook. It's
yeah.
in process.
Great.
In process, yeah. Okay. So, does anybody have any reports from committees? Been kind of quiet for the last couple of weeks, but I do have a slight update. The last Osgood School Council meeting had to be moved, well, not moved, but we skipped that one, so there'll be another one next week.
Mm-hmm.
And then I went to the Alternative Energy Committee meeting, and the PV arrays are well underway, under construction. One of the members shared some photos, which are amazing, so it's exciting that
mm-hmm.
this has finally come after 7 long years of meetings of things I didn't understand. I understand a lot more now.
Yeah.
So I don't know what the target is for complete completion, and I will ask that at the next meeting when we can expect those to be up and running and actually producing electricity.
At the transfer station.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah, I've seen them.
Yeah, you can
yeah.
see them from afar. You're not supposed to walk near them. Get scolded. Not me, but the person taking the photographs. So I think that's amazing in and of itself. And then Louise is driving the electric vehicle here, there, and everywhere. So.
We've also very much encouraged the IT people to use them
uh-huh.
because that's our most economical use of the vehicles.
Right.
Although we are sharing it with Chris tomorrow. So we're being good.
He actually is canceling.
So.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, so you don't have to share.
I haven't emailed Jennifer yet, but last minute he had to cancel.
I'll tell her.
Okay, and then also just for a reminder, tomorrow night is Deer Hill School Favorites Night, which highlights student art.
Yes.
And I always try and make it to that, so I'm hopeful that I'll be able to go then. We all know that U.S. News and World Report came out with the top school list, and we've moved up the ladder to number 9, so it would be interesting to see, you know, what they judged based on. And so we're benchmarked against all the other districts in the report on the same criteria, but who knows what they benchmarked against last year and this year. So it'll be interesting.
From 19 to 9, from 424
yeah,
to 200 and something.
And it all came out, it just came out last night, so.
AP participation was a major piece. I don't know if it was the year before, but I was like, that would probably help us percentage-wise.
Yeah,
well.
It is.
Yeah.
It is.
Yeah.
There weren't a lot of indicators that they used, and we would be likely to perform well on the ones that they did choose to use. I meant to take a picture of it before I left.
Yeah,
oh,
no,
good.
It was college readiness, percent graduation, and AP participation
okay.
were the three big ones.
So
and
we do well in all of those areas?
So we do well in all of those areas, yes. Yeah, but there's a tomb of exactly how they got to all of
right.
the data. And I find that the U.S. News and World Report rankings tend to be more consistent year to year than Boston Magazine or some
yeah.
of
yes.
the other ones. So, yeah, we were 34 to 19 to 9, so... progress.
That's good. Okay. Does anybody else have any?
Just a couple of quick updates. One is for town meeting on
which
Monday.
Which is next week.
Which
okay.
is, yeah, which is Monday. Just wanted to ask the group whether we thought it appropriate to have some speaking points prepared for Article 20. We would be the most logical. Article 20 is the SPED stabilization
mm-hmm.
Transfer. I think we should be prepared to speak on it and just explain it.
In my meeting with Chris today, I just happened to stop by on other issues, but he asked that be limited to about 30 seconds.
Yeah,
that
sure.
is totally fine. I just, it's always awkward. I don't think it's necessarily the place of the Board of Selectmen to get up and speak
right.
on it, since it was our article.
He is anticipating someone from the school committee
okay.
to deliver, but 30 seconds.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. I'm happy to prepare the 30 seconds, and I'll.
All right, and.
Okay.
I'm thinking that we may get questions from the audience, if we can keep those to a limited time also. I mean, it's pretty straightforward, and the only reason that we're doing this again is because something new and better came along. So it's a transition from one model to the next.
Yes.
I think usually when advisory and the Board of Selectmen both vote unanimously on something, it's less controversial.
There are less
Controversies. It's when it's split votes on advisory, I find that there's, you get more discussion about
right.
a topic.
Yeah.
No,
I
never know.
I don't expect us to have.
But it's good to, I think it's good to explain.
Right. And so I'm happy to take a first crack at it, and maybe Jean, if you can take a look at it, we can't obviously all review it, but if you want
sure.
to go look at it, and then we can talk about
okay.
who gets up and delivers the 30-second message.
Okay.
The second thing I just wanted to ask the group was, we, on our annual agenda, the next thing, one of the agenda items for the May 10th meeting is a review of our school committee goals.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's probably appropriate for us to just quickly go through those goals that we set out at the beginning of the year. These are school committee specific,
mm-hmm.
and quickly look where we are. We still have, you know, 7 weeks after that to scramble
yeah.
to get it done. But I think it might
mm-hmm.
be good just to do that.
Sure.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll include it for the next meeting
mm-hmm.
for
yeah.
a discussion point.
In the next meeting.
We crossed it off a couple because we really didn't need to do it.
Or
we
have
had
time.
Right.
yeah, during budget season,
right.
so.
And then the last thing that I just wanted to mention that came up in budget and finance that John updated Ellen and I that I thought was actually exciting news was the fact that the new payroll system we're cutting over to that as we speak. Because I understand that, John, the next payroll is a dual system. We're doing it in both the old and the new, and then the next payroll
that.
Cycle after that, I think it's a belt and suspenders, and the next payroll cycle after that, we'll, assuming everything goes well, we'll be in the new system.
The plan right now is that yes, the next payroll comes out on May 4th. People will be paid under the old system, but they will run a parallel payroll on the new system, depending on how that turns out. When we move over to the new payroll system.
So this is town-wide, so it would
town-wide.
Be that the town yeah. and the schools are on
yep.
the same system.
Yeah,
yep.
and we are currently on the same system now. So
oh,
this,
okay.
So this affects everybody who draws a paycheck from the town.
Okay.
So does
police,
that
fire, DPW.
Sorry. Does that mean that we have to actually enter the payroll twice? That's.
Yes, it does.
This time we do.
Just
this
time.
This time. It
until
does.
We work out all the kinks.
And how long does that take? It's a cumbersome system. We've got one person working on it.
Correct.
We're buying coffee for Jane.
I think that we should buy breakfast, lunch, and dinner and coffee for Jane. I can't even imagine.
Yeah, it's been, she's been remarkable.
It has
been
an incredible amount
easy.
Of work to get it set up. Next Tuesday, when she enters the payroll, somebody from the payroll company is going to come down and sit next to her.
Okay, so
as
somebody
she,
will
as
be
she
there
goes,
for
as
support.
As she goes through it for the very first time.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And then, again, assuming that, we won't assume anything. If it goes smoothly, then the next payroll will be on the new payroll system, and if there are issues that, frankly, we have or other departments have, it may delay when we go over to the new system.
It's exciting news in the bigger picture of things, because I thought this was happening. I thought it was happening at the beginning of fiscal 18, not during fiscal 17. So it's good news because once we get the transition done, hopefully Jane will be able to reallocate some of her time to some other stuff besides payroll.
Absolutely. The new system will be, the system we have now could be described as usually vicious. This will be friendly. It has some reporting capabilities that we do not have now, and it will do that, and it will free up a lot of time. The very current system requires somebody to enter the information manually onto a spreadsheet to be sent over to Town Hall, where it's manually entered into a system, and then after the payroll is run, it comes back here, and then we have to manually enter the cost centers. The opportunity for miskeying information is, doesn't happen very often, but is certainly always there. Under the new system, we will enter the information once, and some of it will be automated, as a matter of fact.
You'll just be clicking off yes, yes to what's already populated there?
Correct.
Yeah.
And assuming Town Hall will give it a look and make sure they're comfortable with it, in fact, there's a budget to pay for it, it won't be entered a second time. And the big savings in time, one of the big savings in time will be the fact that it will then post automatically. And so when we talk about what does, you know, why this, why the parallel system with it, and it's because we're entering those account numbers, so we need to make sure that we got them right, so that the total is equal in both systems, and they post to the correct accounts, and in fact, the accounting software we have is going to accept those posts. But we get through that, and then this, from the town's perspective, they're not going to be entering it a second time, and from our perspective, we will not be involved in posting the payroll to the right account.
Cost centers, yeah. That was it for me.
Okay.
I just have one.
Is that all right?
So.
No.
This is all right.
What's today, Wednesday? So yesterday was the Cohasset Middle High School School Council. First thing on the agenda was the library, the Learning Commons update, and Carolyn articulated the current plan of, she's going to have seniors on their senior service day on or about June 1st, pack up the library, and they're going to do some metrics to figure out how many totes they need to rent to pack up, and what kind of organization they're going to have for the totes, and find somewhere to store them so that after that day, the library and construction will be good to go. Cindy Matheson reported that after the CEF Gala, they're at about 85% of their fundraising, and they have one or two more events or pushes for fundraising for that. And then we talked about how to get the word out. You know, it's been in the paper, it's been in the newsletters, there's been a lot of that, but how can we use, how specifically the video that was done that was shown at the gala, and that has been on Facebook to really further the message. So we thought, and Chris Senior approved, getting it to loop on a video, on a screen in the lobby of the high school before town meeting.
Mm-hmm.
So that'll be going, and Chris said that would be fine because they're the 250th anniversary committee is having a table there with their information, and the town hall study committee is having a table there with their information, so he saw no reason not to. We talked about maybe getting it down to the senior center during one of their events. You know, they have these breakfasts and these lunches, and Carolyn volunteered to go down for 15 or 20 minutes, show it, and talk to the senior citizens in town about the Learning Commons and how exciting it is. And using this tool that, and I forget the young man's name.
Jack.
Oh, I wanted to call him Sam, but he's Jack. So he actually did the video. You know, he did all the editing. So it was exciting and an interesting way to continue to spread the word about the Learning Commons. The next topic was the middle school study group and the parent survey, and Carolyn had indicated that the middle school study group wanted to do their own survey, their end of year survey, and incorporate it into their study,
mm-hmm.
so that the survey would be part of this project of studying the middle school. And the high school would have a similar survey to last year go out.
Mm-hmm.
The high school last year, most of the questions aligned between the middle school and the high school. There were some variances,
yeah.
but now it would be two separate surveys. But they'll be going out this year. Last year was the first year the middle high school sent out an end of year survey. And then the last thing was talking about the handbooks, student handbooks, which Louise talked about earlier. Carolyn updated group that it's going to be a district handbook with sections for each school that are specific to each school. And then the school improvement plan
for next year. There's still a TBD. Based on what comes out of the middle school study, we kind of felt it was important to have, if something comes out that's tangible, that can be achievable for next year,
mm-hmm.
even if it's not the whole end product of the study, but it should be part of the school improvement plan because the middle school is such a big part of, you know, what the district is. And that's it.
Great.
And last thing is Deer Hill. I know the survey just went out and did not have an April meeting. We've had some public meeting scheduling issues. Yeah.
Without a secretary like Joni on top of it.
Yeah, right. So the next meeting is, I think, May 4th.
The only CPAC leadership meeting was canceled on Monday,
yeah.
But there is a coffee tomorrow at I believe it's at 9:30 a.m. at the Lightkeepers.
Yeah.
And that is open to the public. You don't have to be a member, or you don't have to have a student on an IEP or be part of CPAC to come. So anybody that wants to attend is welcome to.
I'm sorry, when is that?
Tomorrow. 9:30 at the Lightkeepers. Lightkeeper's
house.
Thank you.
Shack.
Beautiful.
No, it's
beautiful.
Actually residence. Lightkeeper's
okay.
Residence.
Oh.
Okay. Anything else? No.
Can I just share a couple of things?
Yes.
No. Deer Hill entryway. If anyone has
oh,
gone
yeah.
to Deer Hill
tomorrow night, I'm excited after the pictures.
Lobby guard is in between the two doors.
Oh,
excellent.
The fobs are in process of being installed and so on. The banker's window has to wait because it will be disruptive to the educational process during the day. So that may be early summer. The entryway is amazing. The children want the rest of the floors to look like that sparkle in the front, the big sea in the Cohasset Sea. The bollards are up at Osgood. There's been a great deal of work done. They were very, very busy over the holidays. So I give them kudos. It looks wonderful.
That's great.
Great.
What's the latest on the gates?
The gates are here.
They were delivered Monday.
Oh, okay, great.
It'll take a little time to assemble them, and then we'll distribute them out to buildings.
Okay, very good.
Yep.
We also want to share that the custodians had a training last week.
Yes.
So on lifting in, what was it?
It was about the proper way to lift and stretch, and
uh-huh.
So we don't have strains and injuries.
Good.
We held it here last Wednesday during the vacation week for our staff, and it was open to facilities as well, so some of the employees from facilities came to the same training, and then today we had a second training, and it was for some of the people who didn't make it last week,
mm-hmm.
But designed around the kitchen staff.
Great. Now, do you have some kind of sign-in sheet or
yes.
and handouts that you're doing?
It was a program that was sponsored and put on by Maya, which is our workers'
yep.
compensation care.
That's great.
Yeah.
That's mm-hmm. great.
We also have a new secretary at Deer Hill, who effective Monday, Heidi Salerno has come on board and agreed, and letter went out today, and it's official. So
when I saw her coming in when I was speaking to you 10 days ago, I'm like, I wonder.
That's great.
That's good.
She did an awesome job.
Mm-hmm. She has just been great, very gracious. That's all the news here?
That's it? Okay. All right, so we have two sets of minutes to approve. The first is Cohasset School Committee meeting, which was a joint meeting with the Advisory Committee on Thursday, March 30th, 2017. Does anybody have anything on this?
No.
The only comment I would make is that Tanya Bodell is actually T-A-N. So do I have a motion to approve the Thursday, March 30th joint meeting with Cohasset Advisory Committee minutes?
So moved.
And do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, and then the second set of minutes is for Wednesday, April 5th, 2017, was the regular school committee meeting. And I have just a couple of little typos. Does anybody else have anything?
Nope.
All right, so, they're just very small, and actually, Tracy, why don't I just give them to you? Because it's just changing a word from is to are, and another word from were, was to were, and then, taking, there's an extra set of motion by verbiage under the superintendent's report gifts. So I'll just pass that along, and if we could have a motion to approve those, with, as amended?
So moved.
Do I have a second?
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, I do not have any topics not reasonably anticipated. And we do not need to have an executive session, I don't believe.
Excellent.
So I would entertain a motion to adjourn at 9:18.
So moved.
Do I have a second?
I'll second.
All in favor? Aye.
Aye. Yeah, I'm gonna make it home, so my baby's here.
Oh, okay, yeah, in the morning, I can.
Okay.
It's only 9:18. Thanks for coming, Jen.